Just the observation about domain names as property. The courts have been pretty clear about that. And my own observation, nothing good has come from that. It's just created all the problems we have with property systems generally and imposed them into the domain name system. But to Carl and Brad's point slash question, ICANN acts like a monopolist in all the worst senses of the word. They embody all the reasons why we generally hate monopolists. And if there were, in fact, true competition among the domain name systems, we would see a much better ICANN.
Basically, the ICANN policy process decided that they would change Whois in certain ways that would make it, it was a compromised position, of course, but it was, they would change it in ways that would make it more privacy protective. And that is when the US government and some other governments basically sent a signal to the GNSO that this was not acceptable. And so that process stopped, and the board let it stop. And what's happened since then is this shadow boxing and dancing around the issue of studies. So we have the GNSO deciding that we need to do studies of these problems. And so the trademark interests and the copyright interests are pushing for studies that are kind of slightly tilted towards discovery information that would strengthen their case to make Whois stronger. And the privacy advocates are trying to get studies done that would say, oh, how is Whois abused, right? So we're just playing a kind of a game here in which we do studies and then we beat each other over the head with them. But nothing fundamentally has changed about Whois since 1982, when you come right down to it, except that ICANN requires you to fill out this information and you are notified by your registrar to keep that information up to date.
I was surprised to see the representations for the United States government saying basically there are no principles of international law that can be applied here. I can't understand why there isn't an outcry from this community to say, well, actually there are. There may be difficulty applying them, but here's how we will help you do that. But to challenge it at the level that the US government has reported as challenging, I found legally and politically and very interesting.
Over and over again in these discussions is gets down to the concept of what's right and wrong in the context of ICANN. And each country has its own constitution and its own rules and has its own idea of what's right and wrong. What's right and wrong in the United States is different than what's right and wrong in China.
If you start from the assumption that anything should get in, because that's more or less the way freedom of expression is being understood in the US, then you are in a situation where you go to the other extreme of imposing the national interpretation of a Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which is absolutely not endorsed even by other governments that are relatively democratic. I mean, on hate speech, there is a strong difference between Europe and the United States. And I think we should all consider this as the management of a common resource and try to find the most acceptable middle ground to alleviate concerns and make sure that we have the most accessibility and the less constraints. But we cannot go in either extreme directions, I think.
In certain respects, some of the privacy advocates are talking about using takedown procedures that that have been pioneered by the trademark owners, which is something I think we need to pay attention to. I think the most extreme case of that is this talk about a right to be forgotten in Europe, where you're asserting a right to take down information about yourself, even if it was public information, like old newspaper articles, after a certain period of time.
Let's say you don't want to do business anymore with this company. Do you think you should have a right to force that company to delete information about you? So we're not talking about, you know, writing to the New York Times and getting them to excise a newspaper article, but more like writing to Williams-Sonoma and saying, you know, I don't want the catalog anymore. Please remove me from your databases. And I have a huge majority, I think it was like 92% agreed with the idea that there should be that law. It's not totally without precedence in the United States. There are some California tort actions where people have been held liable for publishing information that was extremely old about an individual. Truthful and but, let's say, 30 or 40 years old. And the idea is that it's no longer newsworthy, you're just dredging up these old facts about this individual. And there have been people who have been successful in that type of tort suit, but that is it's extremely strange, and I think that modern First Amendment law is making it harder and harder to articulate such a claim.
The more narrow debate now within ICANN is fundamentally about who is and about how much information about you by virtue of your use of internet resources is going to be publicly accessible to the rest of the internet.
So on the issue of anonymous communications, and I think the question is there really value to it, and does the value outweigh the harm? And I think, let me just give you a good example of why we ought not presume that if somebody wants to be anonymous, that it should equal nefarious. There are all sorts of reasons, legitimate reasons, why people would want to remain anonymous and get ideas out and exchange information on the internet, whether it's, you know, a battered wife, shelter, there's just a whole laundry list, dissidents, political activists that want to be able to criticize and comment on policy. So let me give you this example, which here in the United States, when our country was founded, we had a lot of the great thinkers and politicians in the day getting together and writing these papers called the Federalist Papers and the Anti-Federalist Papers. And among the various contributions from the different Thomas Jefferson and John Adams and some of the others was this person called Publius, who was really anonymous. And many of the ideas that came out of his papers and his discussions were able to make their way into the forum and into the dialogue because he was able to do it under this anonymous name. And so, you know, again, there's nothing nefarious, or that we can't assume that somebody is trying to engage in wrong activity just because they want to maintain their privacy.
It seems to me that we have to put this issue in context. In a democracy, where is there access to punishable communication? Nowhere in 95 or 99% of our media can you be anonymous except for a call-in, and they have your phone number. So to have this discussion on the internet, which is a place where democracy could find new ideas, full expression of pro and con, it is important to save that space. And I find, I hadn't thought of it so much, but I do think that anonymity will lead to truth-telling, because truth-telling of a really important sort will inevitably get you in trouble. Just see what happened to Julian Assange. I mean, this was the most important communication to know how my government money was being spent. And he and his potential cohorts are suffering miserably. You know, waterboarding is not torture. And that poor corporal who's in naked every night in suicide gear, this is Manning, this business. So we do need a space. We need a space to communicate. We need a space to tell, to talk, to speak truth to power.